Hello, and welcome to part 3 of the TI Precision Lab on current feedback amplifiers. Part 1 of this series introduced current feedback amplifiers and explained the stability theory behind this type of device. Part 2 of the series focuses on the slew rate performance and the internal architecture of a basic current feedback amplifier. This video will focus on performing SPI simulations to obtain the rate of closure and phase margin of a current feedback amplifier. Please be sure you have watched the videos on op-amp stability and the previous current feedback amplifier videos. The table shown reviews the terminology used for the stability analysis of a voltage feedback amplifier and displays the equivalent terms for a current feedback architecture. The TINA figures shown highlight the circuit needed to obtain the stability curves for each type of amplifier. It is worth noting that the beta factor of a voltage feedback amplifier and current feedback amplifier is not the same. This is because rather than error voltage, our focus is on the error current at the inverting input of the amplifier. Because we are measuring an error current, the equation of our beta factor is also changed, as explained in part 1 of the current feedback amplifier series. The feedback factor is the major difference between obtaining the needed stability curves for a current feedback rather than a voltage feedback amplifier. The following slides will be a quick review in performing a stability analysis for an amplifier using TINA TI. Moving forward, we will be obtaining the phase margin of a THS3491 current feedback amplifier. It is clear that the model of this device does not have the typical shape of an amplifier, but rather contains a few more pins. While most of the pin descriptions shown in the table are straightforward, the power down and feedback pins may cause the most confusion. In order for the device to function properly, the power down pin must connect to a voltage of 1.5 volts or above. Otherwise, the THS3491 will enter a power down state. For the purposes of this video, we will tie the power down pin to our positive supply. The feedback pin, FB, and output pin, Vout, have an internal connection within the model. Essentially, both pins function as the same node. The first step in obtaining our open loop curves is to check the DC operating point of the circuit to confirm the amplifier is properly biased. This can be done by clicking Analysis, DC Analysis, and Calculate Nodal Voltages. In this case, we can see the bias current is around 1 microamps and our output voltage is 8.3 millivolts. The output voltage is a reflection of the input offset voltage times our noise gain, giving us an input offset voltage of around 1.65 millivolts. Comparing both DC values with the respective ranges in the datasheet, we can see that both the simulated input bias current and input offset voltage meet the specifications of the THS3491. Now that we have confirmed our amplifier is biased correctly, we can run an AC transfer characteristic analysis over the bandwidth of our amplifier. This can be done by clicking Analysis, AC Analysis, and choosing AC transfer characteristic. The start and end frequencies shown are set to match the frequency range used in the open loop response of the THS3491 datasheet. Once the analysis is run, we will see the magnitude and phase for our output voltage and error current curves, Vout and IFB. Similar to what is done with a voltage feedback amplifier, we will use the postprocessor to generate our open loop transimpedance, or ZOL, and our 1 over beta curve. In the postprocessor, the equation for our open loop transimpedance, ZOL, and our 1 over beta curves can be entered. While the loop gain curve is already provided in the Vout curve, a quick check of the ZOL and 1 over beta curves will help us confirm that the loop gain curve shown is accurate. Once we have our curves, we can check our ZOL curve by comparing it to the open loop transimpedance curve found in the datasheet. In order to check the 1 over beta curve, it would help to change the y-axis to logarithmic so that we can find the value in ohms. Once we find the value using the cursor, we should confirm that this ohmic value is close to what would be obtained if using the equation RF plus RI times NG. If these curves do not match the expected results, either there is an issue with the built circuit or the spice model for the amplifier was not intended to generate open loop curves. In this simulation, both the open loop transimpedance curve and the 1 over beta curve match the expected results. Once our ZOL and 1 over beta curves are confirmed, we will reformat our graphs. The unneeded error current, or IFB curve, was hidden, and changes were made to the ranges and increments of our X and Y axis. The values that were changed on each axis are highlighted in red boxes and are formatted for easier visibility and analysis. Finally, we will find our phase margin by placing a cursor where our loop gain curve, Vout, has a magnitude of 0 dB. Using the legend, we can find the phase of loop gain at this frequency and determine our phase margin, which is around 60 degrees in this case. The recommended feedback and gain resistor values provided in the datasheets of current feedback amplifiers typically try to provide around 60 to 65 degrees of phase margin. That concludes part 3 of our current feedback amplifier video training series. Thank you for watching, and please take the quiz.